Two. Welcome back to WNST and Baltimore Positive. We have a very special post-bye week edition of our Baltimore Positive. We are down at the Sagamore Spirit Development of Rye. I've had meals here. I've had some beverages here. Now we're getting to know Marc Weller here. Don Moeller joining us here from Baltimore County and former Baltimore County executive. And it's Baltimore Positive. And this, we've set this up for a long time, and I think we ordered sunshine behind us. But this will make the place.
We need some rain.
Absolutely. Yeah.
We need some rain. You normally are having your chicken and waffle. Mark, I tell you, he's a chicken and waffle guy at a lot of our spots. Today, I think we're talking a little Sagamore rye later on. Nestor, what do you think?
Well, yeah, it's that time of the day here, I think, as well. First off, welcome. I know you wanted to come. We had a lot of things on our mind, and Don's put together all this stuff. We always start at the beginning. You're not from around here. You're a Buffalo guy, right?
Yeah, I grew up in Buffalo until I was 15. Then I moved to Maryland.
Bills?
So, yes, I'm a Bills fan.
Sabres?
I'm a Bills. I'm a Sabres fan. I'm also a Ravens fan. That's hard to believe. I'm a big Ravens fan, and I'm just a Baltimore fan in general. And it's interesting because, you know, one of the things that attracted me so much to Baltimore and really allowed me to get a passion for it really quickly was how much it reminded me of Buffalo, except it had so much more opportunity than Buffalo has, in the sense that it's right here on 95 between Washington and Philadelphia and New York. Literally, the Port Covington project has, you know, three exits off of 95 with 46 million cars going by it a year. We have Amtrak running to New York and Washington and so on, and Boston.
Maybe maglev soon or something similar.
Hopefully maglev soon, which would be even more of a game changer. But when you think about that, it really brings you back to the narrative and the understanding of a lot of American cities that just kind of have not seen the prosperity that other cities have seen. And, you know, people ask why. And Baltimore, to me, always just seemed like a city that was just ready and ripe for a lot of redevelopment. There's so many positive, incredible things going on in Baltimore to begin with, but to be able to take that, enhance on that, focus on the things that weren't so good and try and help fix those, that was the opportunity, and that's what gets me so excited about working here in Baltimore.
Sounds like Baltimore Positive right there.
My goodness.
In a nutshell. Like, taking the potentiality. I mean, I'm literally standing here, we're looking at 95. Like,
yes.
You could throw a football there. You could hit a golf ball there. That's how close this is.
Yes.
And yet this, other than the Baltimore Sun Project, and I've lived here a long time, it was, I don't want to say vacant, or but I lived down here. There was a Walmart here for a while. This space and what it is, other than the place we look at them and see the port or see the ships come in on the weekends, you guys have really expanded the concept of what this is going to be. And I remember when Ed Hale took me up onto his project 15, 20 years ago and told me what that was going to be. And he showed me the blueprints. And now I go over there and I say to Ed, damn, if it didn't happen, pretty much the way you said it was going to happen.
Yeah.
You guys have laid this out. We're already in a nice, you can come down here and see what's happening, and things are happening down here, right?
Yeah, I think, you know, one thing to point out is when we took over Port Covington, it was a series of transactions, and those transactions totaled up to over almost 250 acres. And thinking about that, nobody really knew where Port Covington was, and it was our goal at first to make people understand that Port Covington was a place. It was right there in Baltimore, and it wasn't just the place where the big gray ships are, and it wasn't just the place where the Walmart used to be or any of that, or the Sam's Club used to be.
Now, you know why I know about this? Because John Stedman,
yeah,
my mentor and hero at the Sun, wanted Camden Yards to be here.
Yes.
You knew that, right?
I've heard those stories,
I mean, and John went crazy about it because it was off of 95, and of course, it got built next to a warehouse. And 30 years later, everyone's tried to emulate that, right?
Sure. Yeah, no, that was an incredible build. But I think they were onto something when they looked at it from that direction. So what I like to say about Port Covington is, you know, we actually call this our Phase 1A. We have our Phase 1B, which is really the next phase that you see that's happening out here. Now, in Phase 1A, just to put it in perspective, has hundreds of millions of dollars of investment put into it, into the buildings, including this the distillery and the distillery restaurant, Rye Street, and Sagamore Spirit Distillery next door, a City Garage, which is our building where our makerspace.
I've been there many times recently.
That's right. We have South Point, which is our temporary activation space. We have Nick's Seafood. We have the Baltimore Sun, their headquarters. We have over 500,000 visitors a year coming through Port Covington now, whereas when we started this, we had almost none. Under Armour now has almost a quarter of its headquarter workforce right here, located in Port Covington in Building 37. They've bought their campus and their campus location next to us. So, you know, what I think about is like the project, people are just, when is the project starting? It already started.
Well, I want to jump back there, Mark, because I think that's exciting when you talk about Phase 1A. And we got folks, you know, watching on Facebook or driving in their cars listening. First of all, always say, let's do the four dummies thing here. Tell folks where, give them a picture of where Port Covington is, and then I really want you to walk us through 1A again, because we're sitting in this beautiful restaurant. So start, for folks who may not know, they've heard it, they've read it. Where is Port Covington?
Well, I get asked that a lot, especially when I'm around the country. I travel a lot for work, and I travel a lot for my five children. They all do different various sports that lead me in different places. And they say, oh, well, where are you working? What do you do? And I always have to explain. And I always say, well, you know where the tunnel is, the 95 tunnel? And they go, yeah. And I said, do you know where those big gray ships are? And they go, yeah, yeah. And I go, everything there to the right before then. Like everything, I said, yeah, everything for a couple miles. We bought everything there. And people go, oh, I got it. Now, the fun part now, here we are a couple years into this, and I can be anywhere in the country. And if you've driven by here in the past couple years, I go, did you see the water tower with the three diamonds on it, which we built for the distillery? And they go, oh, yeah, the one with the three diamonds. Right there. It's all that land there. So that's becoming a landmark and sort of something to use as a beacon for Port Covington.
Other cities, and I think my Baltimore Positive dreams about doing this really began last year. Dom was running the county, and I'm on airplanes flying to places. And I've flown all over the world, right? Next couple weeks, I'm going over to Tokyo in Asia. I'm going to ride the bullet trains. I'm going to be... So last year, the Ravens road trips were Nashville, Cleveland, Charlotte, the usual. I'm always in Indianapolis, right? I go to Pittsburgh every year. Yeah. And I see these cities that 20 years ago were places where, like, I didn't want to be on a Saturday night, right?
Sure.
Like, you go in, you say, Charlotte, my God. And now you go every 8 years when you get to be 51 like me. And you've gone three or four times over the last 25 years. And you go to Cleveland every year. And I see what the flats were in the 90s.
Yeah.
Then it went away, kind of looked like this maybe 10 years ago. And then it came back, and now... It's this people have to see that 10 years from now, 5 years from now, if they want to come. This is going to be a place they can come down here, live, work, eat, sleep, all within a spit of Camden Yards and the harbor and all the other things. And 95, it's a natural, but I think people can't see it unless they've been somewhere else and said,
yes, that's right.
Hey, that maglev's going to make us Brooklyn like this.
Yeah.
But you have to have been to Brooklyn 30 years ago to say, nobody wanted to be in Brooklyn 30. Now everybody wants to be in Brooklyn.
That's right.
There's a part of the coolness and the hipness, but it all takes people like you and government working like this to make something like this become something other than a blueprint, right?
Yeah, that's right. I mean, and going back to what Don was asking about before, is like, what's here now and how do we get to the next phase and when does it take place? So what's here now is we have the Sagamore Spirit Distillery, which is sitting right here that we're sitting in, the restaurant called Rye Street Tavern, which is right next to that. We also have a building called City Garage, which houses all kinds of new businesses that are startups and so on. And then we also have the Baltimore Sun and their headquarters, which is across the street. We have Nick's Seafood. And then next to us here, we have the first Under Armour building, which is a quarter of their headquarters campus and the people there. So that's sort of the base of Port Covington that's here now. Right now, we've actually started. We started in May of this year. We started with the dirt work, which was our real official groundbreaking, to get us to about 1.5 million square feet, which we'll deliver in about 2 years from now. So 2 years from now, you'll come down here and you will see something that you just can't believe. There will be people walking around. There'll be people living down here. There'll be people using hotels, apartments, office buildings, all the different uses you can imagine. There'll be housing for all different types of folks. There'll be
2 years.
Yeah, two years from now, about 2 years.
Wow.
Yeah.
Well, I loved your quote, Mark, and I actually circled it in one of the events. Maybe it was the groundbreaking in May, where you said, this project is real and we're open for business. Because I would imagine when I get around, I'll have people say to me, and it must drive you nuts, is Port Covington real? And they use that term.
Yeah.
That's why when I saw you say that, I thought, man, what a great quote. And I get it all the time. Is it real? Is it really going to happen? Why do you think people have that skepticism?
Well, I think there's just generally a skepticism in really large-scale thinking. And I think it goes back to what Nestor was saying, which is it's very hard. Construction and development and things that don't exist now are hard for many people to see if you don't do it for a living. It's hard to understand what they look like finished. If you worked in big government, you know, high-level government, and worked on projects and you've seen a vision turn into people living, working, and playing there, you understand how real it is. But if you haven't actually touched and been involved with it or studied cities and been to places like Nashville where you were here then, you were here while it was under construction, now you're here where there's people hanging out.
It used to look like Harrisburg when you
drove up. That's right.
Then the Bat Tower came.
That's exactly right.
And now it looks like Manhattan when you drive up.
That's right.
And I've seen Vancouver. I mean, I've seen these cities just absolutely transform. I haven't been to Austin in 15 years. People tell me I won't recognize it when I get there.
That's right. That's right. But that's the deal. And I think that the urban, sort of the push for an urban lifestyle, and, you know, like you have, you know, folks my parents' age who are in their mid-70s who want to live in a more urban context now. They want to turn the key and leave. So you have everybody from the young folks just graduating college all the way through the older folks that are retiring looking for their version of something that's more convenient, easier, and just friendlier to turn the door and leave. And a lot of, in many cases, using less and not more. Maybe not having that big house anymore, but having smaller places. So that urban push and the urban revitalization that's taken place because of it is very real. And you have to drive it, and you have to have certain key components to drive it. But Baltimore has it all. I mean, literally, I mean, we have three exits off 95 right here, which is almost impossible to get. We have 2.5 miles of waterfront right there. So we have an airport right there, only a few miles away. We have a light rail stop, you know, less than a mile away. We have stadiums right there, downtown area. So it's just, Baltimore is just ripe, really ripe for some really significant change and upswing to take advantage of what great things are already here and kind of push them into the next phase.
Everybody we talk to talks about Baltimore's assets. You know, they talk about the healthcare system, the incredible medical care, the arts and science community.
Yeah.
Then you talk about, as you just did, the port, the highway system, the fact that all of the pieces are there.
Yeah.
And getting folks to come together and make this happen. You know, it's interesting, Mark, when you talk about excellence and the vision. I remember, I don't know, it may be 5 years ago now, when Kevin Plank and his folks were branching out into the liquor business, and they were going to create a rye, and they were going to brew their own rye. And I can remember I said to one of the folks at the table that day, so what's the goal? I said, we want to make the best rye whiskey in the world. We want to make the best rye whiskey right here. And it's interesting. Twice in the past 5 or 6 weeks, I've had folks in from out of town, from the West Coast, and they'll see the Sagamore, and they'll go, that's my favorite rye.
Yeah.
I'm telling all my friends.
I got to give a shout out to David Rose right now from Sagamore. D. Rose.
David Rose, he's amazing.
That's my, you know, that's my Manhattan connection.
Yeah.
You know, so he's always pouring it for me. I see you guys are over at the farmer's market every Sunday with the, you have certainly, for Baltimore, we all know what it is here.
Yeah. Well, I think you've locked on to something really important. And, you know, first off, want to start by just saying, like, getting a chance to work near or around Kevin is an honor and a privilege, because he thinks big and he thinks great. And so not everybody thinks like that. And many of us go through our careers and go through our lives, and we run into situations where we thought that way, but reality brought us back down to earth. Kevin has really worked hard at being a visionary, and really worked hard at, he's just born to do it, really worked hard at seeing some of those visions convert to reality and then help the surroundings around him.
How'd you meet Kevin?
I met Kevin, actually, my best friend from growing up from high school at Wooten High School was a guy named Billy McDermott. And Billy McDermott really wanted to play Division I football, and he wasn't quite ready to go play. So he went and did what's called a post-grad year. You know what that is, a fifth year. And he went down to a place called Fork Union Military Academy. Hardcore place. A lot of pros, and so I've gone there. And during that senior year, there was a group of young men from the area schools, the private schools and the public schools, and Kevin Plank was one of them. So I ended up meeting Kevin through Billy. They were all going to Fork Union together. And then I immediately was drawn to a couple of Billy's friends, his new friends, and Kevin was one of them. And, you know, he was just a really, really fun and energetic and magnetic guy. So just always liked him.
But how does this – how does that become this?
Well, I think Kevin will say this too. He has, and I like to think that I have the same skill, is he has an incredible knack for noticing people that are good at certain things. And so Kevin and I always stayed in touch, and I went around my career and learned how to build things, learned how to develop things, learned how to see things through, how to get them financed, learned all about the industry, built lots of things, had a lot of success, had some failures, and through that, that. Always stayed in touch with Kevin and watched Kevin and his business grow. He was always incredibly generous to me and friendly to me, bringing me around to anything he had going on. And I just got a call one day from him in 2011 on his way home from the beach. Memorial Day, I was barbecuing at my house. I won't forget it. And
this is not that long ago.
No, it's 2011.
We all remember 2011 doesn't feel like long ago.
No, right. It's not. Now we had talked because I used to come and poke around Baltimore, and he would encourage me to do that. He'd get wind that I was up here poking around, and he would encourage me to poke harder and get something done. Not necessarily recruiting me to work.
Do something for the city.
Just, hey, why don't you go talk? I'll introduce you to this guy. He was always incredibly helpful trying to do that. So long story short, when he called me on that day, he just said, hey, I have some really big things I'm thinking about, and I'm not quite sure exactly how to get them done, but I want to show them to you and get your thoughts. That's what it was. And he said, come up and see me. So I came up to Under Armour. I came up to the new campus and met him in his office. And I knew Under Armour had grown dramatically, and I knew it was a very different company than when it had started. But I guess I didn't really understand the level of company it had become, the level of professionalism, the level of talent, the sheer amount of people working there. You know,
from all over the world.
Yeah. It had become really something very different than unless you see it, you couldn't understand it. And spent some time with Kevin, and he had a lot of ideas. And you know, one of the ideas was, hey, I want to do these things. And he threw out these ideas that he wanted to do. And his idea was, couldn't this benefit everything around it if we did it and made it great? You know, and one of the first things that I heard out of Kevin, which was really fun and different for somebody like me, was that, you know, we don't change the narrative. We want to change the story around Baltimore, you know. Like, I don't want to hear the first thing that when we talk about Baltimore isn't going to be about The Wire.
Isn't going to be about the show Homicide.
And I can tell you some fun stories.
Well, we all get off planes and they say, you might say I'm from Buffalo, but I'm from maybe... Yeah. I don't know. If I meet you on a plane,
I'm from Baltimore.
You say you're from Baltimore.
I'm from Maryland, really, is what I'm from.
Originally from Buffalo, but I live in Baltimore. Yeah. You say that. Right. Yeah. He doesn't say Catonsville. Yeah. I lived at the Inner Harbor for 2 decades.
Yeah.
Man, 2 decades. You talk about how Charlotte's changed in Nashville or whatever the perception would be of Music City and what that used to be. You say Baltimore, used to say, oh, Camden Yards, Crab Cakes, Cal Ripken. Went to the Science Center, the Aquarium, the Wacky Mare. Now it's The Wire, and we got to change that.
Well, I think to be honest with you, that narrative is changing. You know, you're constantly battling that narrative, but it's changing. And when Kevin said, I want to change the narrative around the city and said things like that, I have to tell you, being from what I had been through and what I had been doing, it was a challenging thought to get my head around. First off, for a mid-sized local developer to talk to an international business builder, entrepreneur, and hear those words, it's not the same. They don't exactly compute perfectly, right? I'm saying, they go, oh, we're going to change the narrative. What does that even mean, right? What is Kevin thinking versus
speak?
I don't know. So you know, what I started to figure out.
This isn't a lacrosse team. Right. That's right. A city, right?
Yeah. No, but over a few months, I started to really realize what he was doing. And then there was a point where you say, we're going to change the narrative, and I'm going to drink that Kool-Aid that we're changing the narrative, or this isn't the place for me. And I really believed in what he was saying, and I really believed in all the things I told you in the beginning of this conversation about Baltimore's location, about Baltimore's character, about Baltimore's people. And I just said, we're going to change the narrative. And I started saying it and believing it. And then everybody around – but that's how it started. And people around me started saying and believing it. And if you didn't believe it and truly believe it, you were gone. We didn't need to fire you. You would just wash out. You didn't belong here. Because it takes that type of will and that type of determination and that type of thought in order to really change anything and really do anything great. And, you know, just to give you like some little stories off that, like the hotel is a great example. You know, I started walking in the meetings when we started working on the hotel project.
You're talking about the Pendry?
The Pendry Hotel, which won number one hotel in the United States last year out of anywhere. Condé Nast Reader's Choice, number one in the U.S. And I used to walk in and say, this project is going to be world class. And I'd slam my fist on the table. Oh, I'll go back a little further. When I first got into that project, a lot of people had an idea what that project was going to be. They said it's not going to be the Four Seasons. But it'll be above the Marriott. It'll be somewhere between. And I started listening to that kind of for a few months. And one day I was at home and I was thinking about it by myself, had a few minutes to myself, and I said, that's not what we're going to be. We're going to do our own thing, and it's going to be great. I don't know exactly what it's going to be. I don't know if it's above this or below that or whatever it is. We're just going to be great. And from there forward, that was what the mantra became. We were going to build a world-class hotel. We are going to build a great, great living room for us here in Baltimore. We're going to build an unbelievable hotel that will represent this city, the people in it, that everybody's welcome. And that was our goal. And I think people were really surprised when we produced the product we produced, and then when it's been recognized with the way it's been recognized.
Well, and you know what's exciting about the Pendry and the Chop House that's there? What it's done, Mark, is what Nestor and I have been on this crusade now for, you know, 6 or 9 months, and that is a place that brings people from the suburbs back to Baltimore.
Yes.
I a number of couples that I know say, you know what we're going to do? My wife and I are going down. We're just going to treat ourselves overnight at the Pendry. We're going to have dinner at the Chop House. They've heard such great things about it. So that's having the effect. Here's the place where, as one of our guests pointed out last week, where Homicide was filmed, and now here we have the Pendry.
This is not to be disrespectful, and I'm sure some people might hear this and not be that pleased with it, but the day that we bought the hotel from the previous ownership, I called my property manager.
And it was nothing, right?
It was run down. It was literally falling in the water.
Yeah, literally.
But there was a shiny plaque on it. There was a shiny plaque on it that said Homicide. I called my property manager. I said, Aaron May, incredibly dedicated guy. And I said, go down there with a screw gun and take that thing off the side of the building. He goes, what are you talking about? I go, take it off the building. And he goes, what do you want me to do with that? I go, throw it in the harbor.
Throw it in the port.
And he said, I can't do that, boss. I said, okay,
we
fine.
Should
I said,
bury it in said, under the middle.
Give me that.
I said, it's fine. Go hold it. So he took it down, and we got some calls. And I understand why we got some calls. That was a part of Fells Point history. That was a part of where I worked and a lot of things. And I understood all that, and I cared. But what I felt as if there was a much larger sinister narrative tied to that, which was the ugliest word that I can think of, or one of the ugliest words I can think of, particularly here in Baltimore, which is the word homicide.
Right.
And to me, I was not going to be associated with it, and it drew me back to my original intention of why I came here, my original belief in Kevin and his goals, which was we are going to change the narrative around Baltimore. And nowhere in that narrative did the word homicide deserve to be prominently displayed as if we were proud of it.
Well, you know, when you say change the narrative, and you believe and you bought in, I always tell the story. I was at Sagamore one day, and Kevin was kind enough to have both my friend Kevin Kamenitz and me out there for a tour. And you can picture, knowing Kevin and his high energy, he goes, you guys want to see the whole place? Jump in a truck. You know, so we jump in a truck, Kevin grabs the keys, and off we go. And you go down and see the barn, you go see the new track. And I said, what's going to happen here? Why are you doing all this? And he said, because we're going to win it. We're going to produce Triple Crown winner.
Yeah.
And I can remember for months, I still to this day say, let me just tell you, there's no doubt in my mind that Kevin Plank is going to produce a Triple Crown winner.
Yes.
I mean, he believes, and he will make that happen. Same sense of energy that you feel here.
I think you know, that's what we were born to do. I mean, it's just I believe, you know, people say, you know, a lot of people used to say about different things, you know, that other people do for them. Well, it's not curing cancer. I get it, we're not curing cancer, but what we're doing is really, really important. I think everybody at Weller Development, everybody associated to this project, feels as if this is a higher calling of something that can help lift a city, lift the spirits, and really, really bring prosperity to many folks that haven't had that same opportunity. And you have to understand, like, the our company and who we are and what we believe in. We're truly a double bottom line company. We don't have shareholders, we're not publicly traded, but our investors, they don't hold any more sway than our stakeholders. Our stakeholders are just important. Our stakeholders are the communities in the South Baltimore 7. Our stakeholders are the communities that include Cherry Hill and Westport and all these communities that have been, for more or less better terms, they've been left behind. And we want to make sure that folks there get these opportunities. We want to make sure that folks citywide get these opportunities. And that's not something I'm saying we're going to fix, but I'm saying something that we can have something to do with. We can have a part to do with. And that's why I'm so happy to have this relationship with Baltimore County and the executives there, because I think together, I think one and one equals a lot more than what it normally equals, right? Because I think that when we work together, we can really affect positively a lot more people around job training, around creation of jobs, and so on.
Well, Johnny spoke a lot about that when he sat with us. I think we'll take a quick break. When we come back, so much talk. I want to thank our sponsors, Fadley's, Jennings, State Fair, always remind people, go check out thread.org. Want to make a difference in the city? Go check out thread.org. Become a volunteer. Want to hear more about how we got community buy-in when we get back? I want you to give us the Four Dummies version of TIFF. People hear it all the time. They don't have a clue what it is.
Sure.
I want to hear more about growing up in Baltimore. Where are we, Nestor?
We are at rye. I'm looking at a bunch of rye and Sagamore spirits down here. I'm not drinking any yet. That's just because David Rose isn't here.
We'll break it out soon, I promise.
We are WNST.net, AM 1570, and WNST Baltimore Positive, and we never stop telling great stories about good stuff going on around the city.